Now, everyone knows over the past sort of like few years, my big pet project hasn't been my own career. It's been get Karl famous.
Yeah.
I want people to recognize him in the street, come up to him and say, "You bald-headed mank twat." I
Well,
want.
let me tell you now, Rick,
Go
I've been
on.
out and about and a lot of people have come up to me and said, "It has Karl Pilkington got a head like a fucking orange."
Well,
And
I've
I've had
been.
to instantly confirm the answer to be yes.
But he's had a call. He had a call recently from a film company asking him if he's got any ideas for movies. Now, how desperate, in what dire straits must the British film industry be that they're going, "We need Karl Pilkington. We have hit rock bottom." And he went along for an interview.
So what, and you went in and you.
I went along and had a meeting, and they just said, "Right, got any ideas?" And sort of said, what are you thinking? What sort of thing are you after? Are you after action, thriller, whatever?"
Because you could provide any of
I
them.
love that he's playing it cool, like, "You've come to the right person. My time's precious. What do you need?" "Yeah, I'm Karl Pilkington, the movie doctor. What do you need, Papa?"
So thought of this idea sort of on the spot, and that
Good
whizzed by
planning.
him. No, but sometimes that's how good ideas come up, don't
Yeah.
they? Just
So a lot
random.
of yours have come up, yeah.
No, but when if you just
Randomly.
talk, I find that your mouth comes out with stuff.
Right, there's another quote. There is another quote.
If you talk, your mouth comes out with stuff.
That to me is stands along with what were those things in Gremlins called?
No, but what I mean, if you sit there and try and use your brain to do it,
Right.
it doesn't work the same. Just keep talking. Just keep your mouth talking, and eventually it will come out with something pretty good.
That is exactly what Plato said
Well, so
to
anyway.
Aristotle. He said, "Sit down, I've got an idea for you." Aristotle said, "Plato, how do you go? Right, just keep talking, and eventually your brain will come out with stuff."
So what I thought, I just started off by saying like actors' names and that who I thought should be in it, because then that's giving more. It's building.
Right,
Okay,
so
let's
who did
start
you
at the
say?
beginning.
Who did you say?
So I said, "Right, I'm seeing Clive Warren."
Who's Clive Warren?
The one who was in Closer.
Clive
Clive
Owen.
Owen.
Right, all right.
Did they look
I
at you
think I
like you're a
said
fucking
Clive.
idiot?
So they all started trying to figure out who's this Clive Warren we've not heard about? He
He's
must be
a
amazing.
yeah,
He's
man, Clive
obviously.
Warren. Get me Clive Warren on the phone.
Who's got
Get
Clive
me
Warren?
Clive Warren.
And I said, Rebecca De Mornay, right?
She hasn't been in a film for 15 years, has she?
Clive Warren and Rebecca De Mornay. They thought he was a genius. They've never thought of putting Clive Warren with Rebecca De Mornay.
But hang on a minute, you could have any film star. This is your fantasy casting, and you choose a bloke that doesn't exist and a woman who hasn't been on TV or in a film for 10 years. Why didn't you choose,
Someone who existed.
J-Lo or someone who's a big star? Oh
So anyway,
God.
starts off, and the people, you're seeing into their lives from like the morning. So it's like a nice sunny day. Radio's on. They're going about the day. They're having the breakfast. They're saying, "Oh, what we're doing tonight?" And you're thinking, "Oh, they've got a nice life." She's like, "Love you and all that." He walks out the house, gets hit by a bus.
Oh.
So Clive Warren's
dead.
I don't know if Clive Warren would take that part
because
because
he ain't
he
got much to do, has he?
No, I don't. If I know Clive
And
Warren,
I think you do.
I think I do. Carry on. So he's hit by a bus, so he's
So he's
dead.
hit by a bus and that. The titles come up.
Oh,
It's got you,
yes.
right? She's
Starring
devastated. She's
Clive
fed
Warren.
up. She's devastated and that. Doctor says Clive's dead.
Who's playing the doctor? Jack Nicholson House.
What's that fella who was in Independence Day?
Will Smith.
No, the old black fella.
Morgan Freeman.
Get him in. He's
Morgan
the
Freeman,
doctor.
yeah.
He says, "Your husband's dead." She's like, "Oh God." What happens then is he says, "But listen, what we can do now, we can take the brain out."
Right.
And a fact that I read that day before the meeting, this isn't in the film now, this is me.
Right, but
Right.
lucky, yeah,
Okay.
luckily
I
you've made
read
the
a
fact.
thing about how the brain can it can run on half of it. You've actually got a full brain,
Some
on it
of us
and
have.
half. So this was in my mind still.
Well, half your mind, yeah.
So I said, what happens is Morgan Freeman says, "Been working on this. You can run your life on half a brain."
Right.
She's sort of a bit like, "What are you telling me this for now? My husband's just died like 20 minutes ago."
Yeah.
And he goes, "Yeah, but if we're gonna do this, we've got to act quick." She's like, "Do what?" He says, whilst his brain's not fully dead, because it stays awake for a bit when you've
been killed. He's not dead then, fine.
No, but he is, but they found out that it stays awake a little bit.
No,
he's gone. You're hit by a bus.
Yeah, he's dead. If the brain's dead, you are dead.
Clive Warren's dead.
And if the brain's not dead, you're not dead.
No, but it's like people in a coma. They're dead, aren't they? But
No, they're not in a coma.
No, they're dead. They come out of comas, don't they?
All right, then he's in a coma. He's been hit by the bus, but the chances are he's not going to come out of that coma, but his brain is still awake. So change that. That's easily done.
Hold on, though. I like this fact that he's in a coma, so they're going, look, he's definitely going to die in this coma. Take the brain out now. Pop the brain out.
But why is that such a weird thing when that's what they do now? That's what they do now.
What is?
That's what they do.
What?
They do that.
What? A brain transplant?
No, but when, like, how I've signed that donor card, if anything happens to me...
No. There's no such thing as a brain donor. Oh, we've explained to you before.
Yeah, but they're working on it. They've said something about Einstein. They messed about with his brain for ages, trying to work out if it was full of stuff. That's what they're doing. They're working on that. There's loads of things that doctors are doing that we don't know about. I've seen some weird stuff on the internet.
Yeah, I know you have. Yeah.
I saw a programme on Channel 5 where a monkey brain was still alive and it was stuck on a stick. And they
were watching the magic roundabout.
They poked it and it reacted.
Right.
So it's still alive. It's being kept alive. And it's only a matter of time. What's the brain linked up to? As long as you can link it up to the eyes and somehow so it can tell the arms and legs what to do, you're laughing.
I love that. Imagine a team full of doctors going, well, we're going to try and do a brain transplant. Carl, as long as you can link this up to the eyes and tell the arms and legs what to do, we're laughing. Cheers, Carl. See you later.
Then what happens is they say... Do you want half of his brain in your head?
She says, definitely not. I'm having you struck off. She starts screaming. She calls the police. He gets arrested.
Yeah, but you'd have said that years ago when people can have, like, someone else's arm put on their body and stuff.
Yeah, but he's only in a coma.
Yeah.
No, but he's not going to come out of that coma. Right. So it's like this or nothing. He's like, look, you know, what are we going to do here? We can either turn the switch off or we can put his head in your head.
But why would
So what they do then, they're going to take half his brain.
Half of his brain, take out half of hers, pop it in place.
Why would she do that?
Because she loves him.
But hold on. Well, wait. What would she then be?
Because this is what I'm trying to tell
you. Okay, sorry.
What happens is, he explains all this, so I mean, this would probably cover about 20 minutes in the film, but I'm just rushing it.
I just switched off, but yeah.
No, you wouldn't. This bit would have you. Mm. So what?
Well, I'd have actually left when I wouldn't have even gone in to see a film starring Clive Warren and Rebecca De Mornay. unless it was 1985.
So the thing is, she's the same as you. She says the same thing. She goes, why would I do that, doctor?
Mm.
And he goes, well, what will happen is he's gone, but you'll have his thoughts. So in the morning when you say, oh, I don't know what to have, will he have cornflakes? His bit of the brain will sort of say...
Have a Weetabix.
Have shredded wheat or whatever. And she's like, oh, yeah, good idea.
Sorry. So the point of this film is that the dead man can remind her what breakfast cereal she likes.
Yeah. So the thought...
What do you mean, yes? So that's it, is it?
No, that's not the only
thing. Oh, wait a minute, this is only act one.
That's just the first bit. Everything's going well. She has it done.
So who is she? Is she herself?
She's Rebecca De Mornay.
Yeah.
But now and again, with him chipping in with a bit of voiceover. So the idea is it's all going well at the beginning. She's...
So she can't decide what dress to wear.
She's had half of her brain taken out and put in a bin, okay? And Clive Warren's half has been put in there. So now she's walking round... Okay.
So she's like a schizophrenic.
No, like I say, the brain is alive, so it's all going well when she leaves hospital.
Yeah.
And she gets a first taste of it, and it's a bit weird to get hold of, because she's sort of... I think when she signs herself out, he's sort of fighting, writing his name and stuff. So there's a few sort of technical things that she has to get used to.
And does Clive's brain know he's now inside her brain?
Does that matter?
Well, I would say it matters, because... Yes. Otherwise,
it does matter, Carl. What's he thinking? What's the point of this? Why has she gone along with this?
Because she really loves him.
But what's in it for him? What does she think?
Well, say if I died, and Suzanne said, go on, I'll have half of Carl's, right? She would wake up in the morning to a thought of me sort of going, oh, you never guess what I've just thought about or whatever. I'd still be there. The rest of your body is sort of waste, isn't it?
But Carl, the rest of your body's sort of waste.
No, it is, kind of. If when someone dies, it's not that person anymore, is it? You can't have a chat with them. So if you could have someone's brain in your head when they're dead, you'd have it, wouldn't you?
What are you talking about? Why would I have someone's brain in my head when they're dead? Well, what else? I've got a perfectly good brain.
So you're telling me you wouldn't have it done then?
Of course I fucking wouldn't.
I can also categorically state I wouldn't either.
Yeah, but you're saying that now, but once you're in that position that someone who, you know, you love and that dies, if the doctor said, do you want it?
No! I go, no! It's madness!
I don't think it's madness!
All right.
So tell me a typical bit of dialogue.
Well, we've done the breakfast scene.
Yeah, that was dynamite. Yeah. That's fucking Oscar winning.
Yeah, can we do lunch?
There may be like at the funeral, because even though the brain's still alive, they still have the funeral, and you can have like a funny bit where they stood around the grave and like there's some relation there who he doesn't like, and she can start laughing and the family are looking at her going, why is she laughing?
Yeah.
And she's sort of laughing and he's saying something a bit rude going, look at her head. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. It's like
stuff on
orange.
The family.
Yeah.
Little cameo for you.
Yeah.
And so you have all that and people are sort of liking the film, thinking, oh, it's quite funny this.
Mm.
And then you hit them hard.
It's the most ludicrous idea for film I've ever heard.
All right, it's the maddest.
Honestly, it really is the ramblings of a mental case.
Right. I have to say though, I am hooked now. I want to know what's going to happen next in the story.
Then what happens is she hears the voice go, Leslie, where are you? Something.
Right.
Her name's not Leslie.
No.
No.
So she's thinking, who's Leslie?
Yeah.
So in her mind, she's going, who's Leslie? He's going, oh.
So he's thought, hang on, I've let something slip.
Let something slip. So she's going, answer me.
Oh.
He goes quiet on her.
Oh.
So.
He was having an affair.
This is the thing. So she's trying to hunt down.
Leslie. And he's got to stop her thinking it.
Then what happens is, I mean, you know.
Where are your backs?
So he's got to hunt down Leslie.
So he's got, she's got to hunt down Leslie.
It's a woman, is it? Another Leslie or
it's
is it
another woman.
Right.
But what happens is, I mean, without ruining the end for everyone. What sort of happened?
Oh yeah, because we don't want to ruin it for them, because this will be filling the multiplexes in no time.
Yeah, no, it's the greatest love story ever told, set in a head.
But listen, let's just hang on a sec though, Carl.
You've got to tell us the end. I don't think you can let people listening, hanging on, waiting for the film.
Just let your mouth talk.
Right. So what I said was maybe what happens is his brain is more powerful than hers.
Right. How is there power? Why is there no power involved?
What I mean is, her brain was running the rest of her body.
Mm. Now he's taking
over. That gets more powerful and overrules her body.
Okay.
Yeah.
She then fancies Leslie.
So it's a lesbian. Hold on. This is building up to a lesbian love. So what the?
Well, it's trendy, isn't it? That. So just have a bit of that at the end. And
so hold on. So he overpowers her. So she is now. A lesbian. What's Leslie getting out of this? Why does Leslie think, hold on, why is my dead lover's wife coming on to me?
Because this is what I'm saying to you. It's relationships. It's a love of two brains.
Right, okay. Again, can anyone out there, can we make that into it? That's a quote. The relationships is a love of two brains.
Well, it's
now, he's got something there, but my point is this. Why is Leslie suddenly turned lesbian?
Because she loves the brain.
But does she know this is Clive Warren?
Rebecca will say something now and again, like, oh, I like me...
Minge.
I like me food done like this or whatever, and it's all about...
Cooked. Dave
likes
I love my food cooked. Wait a minute, Clive Warren on this food cooked.
Yeah, I'm in two minds about this bacon.
Yeah,
what
I'm
going to
turn into a lesbian.
People...
Shredded wheat.
People like what they like. And it's the same way, like I've said to you before, with... Someone who's been going out with a woman and then is found out that she's got a twin sister and they divorce that first twin and go out with the other twin. It's all the same. You're after the same thing, aren't you?
Yes, but that...
When a cat dies, you buy another one. It's the same thing. You want that same...
Yeah, but you don't necessarily switch your sexual orientation. In the case of your twin scenario, they both look the same.
Yeah. Has there ever been one where it's a twin boy and girl? Well, I was going out with her, but I mean, he looks a bit like her.
Yeah. I loved boobs, now I like cock.
This is your problem. You don't know anything. And this theory about if your mouth talks enough, the brain will kick in soon. It hasn't.
I've only been camping a few times, and each time I was glad when it was over. The last time was last year in Lyme Regis.
Yeah.
When did you go camping in Lyme Regis?
Last year. It's all right, Lyme Regis. But it was all a bit of a nightmare, because I was going with my mate, and he said he knew someone who knew someone who had a bit of land in the garden.
Mm. Who had a bit of land in the garden?
What's the point, though, innit? You know, what's the point of camping in someone's garden where there's a sort of, like, a spa down the road and, like, a pub?
No, because you're by the sea, aren't you? It's getting away from it all, seeing the world.
It's not if you're in someone's front garden.
No, back.
Oh, sorry.
Well, there's even less to see except three fences.
No, but it's private, isn't it? So the thing is, he said, oh, it's a great garden, the owners are away, and there's a toilet, an outside toilet that they have getting for like, when they have parties and stuff. Mm. So we get there, and this lad who knew about this bit of land...
Someone's back garden.
Well, yeah. Said, oh, you can't use it, they haven't gone on holiday.
So now you're stuck in the middle of a big civilised conurbation called Lyme Regis. Well, how are you going to survive?
Well, we ended up just sort of keeping on the beach. But
did you pitch your tent on the beach?
Put the tent on the beach. We found somewhere where there was a load of rubbish. So we thought... Nice.
That's the place to go,
Oh,
yeah. Municipal tip.
What was it? Was it chemical waste or just like, you know...
No, just
Coke cans syringes and
but listen, though, you've got to think about that.
Rusty. What's rusty?
If there's rubbish there, it means it was a good place to camp.
Why?
Why?
Because other people have camped there.
Right.
So that's how you've got to look at it. That's like a little tip of...
So you could have slept in a public lavatory.
Yeah, yeah. This one's nice. What? It's covered in shit. Means other people have had a shit here.
Welcome to our 5-star hotel. You'll notice vomit over all the fucking walls.
So that means people have had a good time here. They got right pissed up and threw their lungs up.
So that's where we put down the tent. We put down the tent there. And then
somebody
what was annoying
tent,
is...
He puts down the tent.
We what's her name?
It was already up.
It was
carried
already
it all
up. They
the
carried
way
it
from
all the way
London.
There and they went, let's pack it down.
Yeah. The weird thing was, as soon as we set up, some other people turned up.
Oh, that's all the rubbish tip. Holidaymakers,
they started setting up their tents. Yeah. Like, oh.
No, near... Look, there's some nappies over there.
Yeah.
Nearer the nappies.
And they offered us some sausages.
All right.
My mate said, oh, ignore them. That's like code. For swingers.
What? No! What, so there were some people cooking some sausages, saying, would you like the sausages? We've made too much. And you
it's
said,
just
no,
that
that's
thing.
Code
don't
for
talk
swinging.
To strangers. It's like, we want to get away from it all.
Yeah.
We don't want someone, you know, it starts off with sausages, doesn't it?
And then but what do these people look like?
They were about 45.
Who are they, that?
A man and a woman.
A man and a woman. So what was in it for the bloke?
Some people like that, don't they?
No, I mean, you say, right, I want the bald one, love. If it's like wife swapping, shouldn't one of you be a wife?
No, but I don't know all the rules and that, but...
He's just got a real thing for fucking oranges.
And we didn't want any sausages anyway, so we just sort of
I don't believe sausages is a code for swingers. Because eventually, how many times do they give someone sausages and they go, well, get your pants off, and they go, well, we just have some sausages. They go, oh, this isn't working, this code.
But why
we need
would
a better code.
Why would we be being offered sausages?
Because they're nice people and they're making sausages.
Yeah. Makes you wonder.
We don't... Let's not trust these people. Let's move our tent nearer to the corpse.
Anyway. So, yeah, that was the camping.
September 30th, going away with Suzanne's mum and dad. We're meeting them at Madeira Airport as they're flying in from Manchester. The plane was full and I had a headache. There was a baby sat behind us that was crying its eyes out for the whole flight. Oh. The mother of it said it was upset because its ears were hurting. So were mine. We went to try and find a supermarket. Suzanne's man was having a go at her dad because he didn't have a shirt on. She said he looks a mess and is embarrassed to be seen with him. It's their Ruby anniversary tomorrow.
That's why we went away.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Karl, I know you're fascinated by the concept of the doppelganger, of seeing someone who looks exactly like you.
Yeah.
Jake has emailed in. He says, Karl, if you could spend a day with an exact replica of you... Okay, so somehow they've cloned you, Karl, and you've got him for one day. What would you do with this? What would you make him do? What would you what conversation would you have with him? What would you do? Is there anything you could, you know, how would you utilize him for one day?
Well, they'd both say I'm not bothered, and that'd be the end of conversation.
Yeah. What would do me head in is, does he think the same way, look the same way,
exactly
dresses?
The same?
Yeah.
How would I know which one I was?
Because you'd be you.
That's amazing.
How would I know which
That's
one I was?
That's incredible.
No, because...
That is the most stupid thing ever said by a human being. Can we get the Guinness Book of Records on this? Has anyone, anywhere in the world, said anything more stupid than, how would I know which one was me?
But think about it. This other person's going, all right, thanks for meeting up and that. And I go, hang on a minute. No, you came to me. And then Suzanne would come home and she wouldn't know the difference. And then suddenly you start doubting yourself. And you go, should I be leaving? Or, so how do I know if I am that real one, if he knows what I know?
But you know who you are because you're experiencing it.
But he'd be saying that because he'd say, yeah, it is a bit weird.
But you know the truth, you idiot.
How would I know which one I was?
So anyway.
But bear in mind,
what would you do?
You could pass him off as yourself.
What would you do? Would you play tricks with people? Would you, you know?
You could be in two places at once.
Would you do stings? Would you do scams?
No, because it would only end up getting me into trouble, wouldn't it? Because people won't believe that there's another one like me. Mm. Otherwise, everyone would be saying that when they get caught robbing. They go, oh, it wasn't me, it was me doppelganger. It can only... I wouldn't want it, to be honest. It's a... again, it's a bit of a headache, isn't it? Because he could be going off, going mental, causing all sorts of trouble, and you're going, will you pack it in? And he's going, what? What are you on about? But then that wouldn't happen, would it? Because he's being me, so he'd be sat wherever I am anyway. Because he'd want to do what I want to do. So, pointless. But I still wouldn't want it.
It's unbelievable.
That was a conversation with himself.
That was amazing.
That was like experiencing what it would be like if there was two cars.
Yeah.
He was having a discussion with himself.
We could have left in that time and come back, and he'd be arguing still.
What does this mean? Does this mean... Does this mean, though, that I could just sit at home and not do anything and just send me out on...
Yes.
And when he's seeing something happen, I'm seeing it.
No.
You're separate people.
You're separate people.
But then he's not a doppelganger then.
Well, you're identical twins then. You found out identical twins and he's got exactly the same input as you. I mean, it's not a real question, is it? It's just a little, again.
But I said to you the other week about twins and that, I wouldn't like to have a twin. It's all right when you're a kid, but unless you're a Siamese twin, even they don't even look alike, do they? They're just stuck together. You don't go, oh, don't they look like each other? They have different haircuts. They don't carry that thing on, do they? That normal twins do. Like normal twins, the mums say have the same haircut, wear the same shirt. Siamese twins never look the same. They've just got their arse stuck together.
Again, it's a dialogue in his own head. It's unbelievable. Okay, Karl. This is a logical conundrum. To a certain extent, there's a little bit of lateral thinking but there is only one right answer. Now, the pressure here isn't to get this right. The pressure is when I've told you the answer to then understand it. Because when I've explained this to people, I've laid out for them, they still can't quite get the concept. Okay, so there's two doors, Karl.
Yeah.
One leads to heaven, one leads to hell. Okay, they're identical, you can't tell them apart. Okay, 50-50.
Right.
Obviously, you want to go to heaven, I assume. Right, okay. There's two guards, identical guards, guarding each door, okay?
Right.
The one guarding hell always tells a lie. The one guarding heaven always tells the truth. You have to ask one question to find out which is which, and then go through the door you want. What question do you ask?
I've only got one?
Yeah.
And what, one to both?
No, one to either of them. You don't know which one's which, though. So what question do you ask?
Why can't I ask, like, both of them one?
Because it's
because
not
the rules.
Rules
are you can only ask one. There aren't actually two doors labelled heaven and hell, Karl. This is a leap of imagination here.
And I've definitely got to answer. I've got to ask them a question. I can't just sort of have a feel of the door to see if there's any heat or anything.
They're identical. You stand a few yards away. You cannot tell from the outside of these doors which is which. What question do you ask?
I can't look through the keyhole or anything.
There's no keyhole.
Get anywhere near them. Let's imagine there's a small rope that prevents you from getting anywhere near, rather like outside a nightclub.
Yeah.
So, they stood there.
Yeah.
They both look the same. They're both smiling.
Yeah.
But one of them's not really smiling, really. He's trying to make me make a mistake, isn't he?
Well, he's just going to lie when you ask him a question, if you ask him.
So what's the point in asking a question? Do I know one of them's going to lie?
Yeah.
But would they be neighbours like this? Would they be that close? Why?
I mean, we're not sure if these two guys get on.
It's a logical... Well, I'll tell you the answer.
No, I want to see if he can get it. He's almost there. No, he's not almost there. What am I thinking?
No, hang on. Right, so you go up and you go.
Hang on. Well, look. Let's imagine Ricky and I are those two guys. Okay. Right.
But we have to, me and Steve decide which doors we're guarding, okay?
Right.
Look away, Carl.
Okay.
Right, so we've decided, okay, one of us is guarding hell and one of us is guarding heaven. Which question you're going to ask and who you're going to ask it to?
Right, I'll just say to you, Steve, I'll go, got some post for God here.
That's not a question. That's a statement.
Right, you've got some post for God here.
No, that's not a question.
Yeah, but maybe the question's coming. You got some post for God here, yeah?
And it needs to be signed.
It's not a question. Still not a question.
No, let him finish. Is God in? Because I need him to sign for this post. Is he in?
Well, I can answer that as well if you want.
Go on.
He's in. He's behind my door. Do you want to answer it?
Well,
yes.
Do you want to get him? Just.
Well, no, you've only got one question.
So you're asking Steve, is God in? What's the answer?
Yes.
Ask me. Yes.
Look, lads, I'm just trying to do a job here. what am I going to do with this?
Well, give it to me and I'll give it to God because he's behind my door. Steve?
Yeah, give it to me and I'll take it into God because he's behind my door.
You're an idiot. Let me tell you the answer. I'm guarding hell, by the way. I'm the devil. Steve's God, okay? So you asked me what Steve would say if you asked him what door he was guarding, and I'm going to lie. I know he'd say heaven because he'd tell the truth, but I'm lying, so I'd say he'd say hell. So the question is, if I was to ask the other one what door he was guarding, what would he say? And whatever the person answers is the door they're guarding.
Steve, what door are you looking after?
Well,
heaven.
Yeah.
Why should I believe you?
Because you don't know. No, that doesn't work. Because you asked me the same and I'd say heaven as well.
Right, so who do I believe? This is where you use your gut feeling though, isn't it? This is what life's...
As opposed to the pure logic that Ricky's just used.
I just think, because there's a lot of questions in life where you don't know the answer and you go, do you know what? I don't like the look of him. So...
They're identical.
Yeah, but they're still identical twins. You always get a little snidey one.
Spoke to Ricky and his friend Glyn about art. I just don't get it. Ricky had some odd pictures on his walls. I don't have any pictures up in my flat because of the mirrored wall. But I can't say I'm bothered. The mirrored wall, we should just explain what that is. When you moved into your flat, there was an enormous mirror on one wall. Was that right?
We just got this flat and, you know, it's not a big flat. So I think the people who had it before us, he was a gay fella, right? Which was a bit like, oh, what have you been doing with that mirror and that? But that was...
What?
No, just, you know. Just,
what?
What? Well, what has he been doing with the mirror?
Well, it's just because they're quite sort of experimental in it, aren't they? And
I don't know. What do you mean? What do they do?
Well, I wouldn't know anything about it, but go on.
No, what do you want?
No, I don't.
Experimental in what way?
What do you mean experimental?
I just mean, you know, they'd be doing stuff.
What?
Whatever they do.
Chemistry. What? A chemistry set out. They'd be doing experiments. What?
No, just doing what?
Singing I Am What I Am and just checking out their dance moves.
I'm not having a go at anyone, but what? I'm just saying, like, they're doing what they're doing. Which
Carl, you're
is
not
annoying
the phone
as well. No, I'm not. This is what.
Why are you worried about what a little gay fella was doing in your flat before you got it in front of a mirror?
I wasn't worried about it.
Are you thinking about what he's doing? Why are you fantasizing what a little gay fella was doing in front of your mirror in your?
I'm not bothered. I'm just telling you why it was a bit odd that he had a mirror in there, right? But forget the history.
But you've got a mirror in there now, haven't you?
No, because what I did was I was going to take it down. And I thought, oh, it's a bit dangerous. This, you know, it could crack and.
Because it's the size of the whole wall, isn't it?
It took up a whole wall.
Right.
So like when he's moving about everywhere, he's got a good view of it and that. But he's got this full wall of mirror, and I thought, I can't set that down. And I thought, what can I do? So I've just put wallpaper on it.
Brilliant.
And it looks all right, you wouldn't know, what have you. But it means that I can't put any pictures up. That's all I'm saying, because I've put a nail in it.
And what don't you understand about art? What about art don't you understand? The concept? Specifics?
No, so that's like when we were in London having a shop around at Christmas and there was that picture of fruit for 700 quid. It's like, well, just get fruit, you know what I mean? You can get some real fruit for 3 quid.
Yeah.
I understand that, but don't invent cameras then, one or the other. Do you know what I mean? That's what annoys me. Someone invents something and then they go, we've got to invent something else. Like the abstract thing. Why has someone gone, oh, I can't have paintings anymore because...
Was it a Dali going mounting clocks and stuff?
I mean, the first one was all right when he did the first clock, but then all the time he's just like, oh, I'll draw something and it's got a melting clock on it. Mm. I'll do a sheep, put one of them on it.
Have you seen his lobster telephone?
That annoys me.
Why?
Because I think what annoyed me more with that is when I heard about how it happened, he had some artist mate round, right? And I don't know what happened.
That's a hell of an anecdote.
No, but they were eating. They were eating some food and what have you.
Yeah. Lobsters?
And, they were eating lobster.
All right.
And,
that's handy.
I don't know, the other artist, whoever it was,
telephone?
Started saying, oh, you and your clocks and all that, right?
Brilliant.
And,
They started
arguing.
Yeah.
And he chucked some of the lobster.
Bollocks.
And it bounced off his mate's head, went on the phone, and they both looked at each other like, are you thinking what I'm thinking? And they brought out that phone as a bit of art. Things like that annoy me. Because it was then just messing about.
That didn't happen.
Just telling you what I know. I saw his work. Each to their own, if that's what he's doing. I'm just saying, I'm not putting my stamp of approval on it. Art should be there to tell a story, not just to have a splash of colour.
Suzanne likes some art. Just like Suzanne's not allowed to watch telly unless it's a favourite thing. Otherwise, she's got to talk to me about stuff. There's no art. There's no point. Just wallpaper.
I'm just saying we've got three windows we can look out of.
Right.
Stop looking at the walls. Look out the window.
My man phoned and said that my auntie Nora, classic auntie Nora, wanted me to look on the internet to find out what the weather will be like in Spain at the end of November. I don't know where she gets her money from. 2 months ago, she was asking me, Dad, how much it would be to get her back garden astroturfed because she's sick and tired of the grass getting out of
her. What does she want to do? Start a football team? What does she want a back garden astroturfed?
She likes the sort of green look, but she doesn't like the headache that comes with it, so she's just looking into getting that false grass put in there.
Brilliant.
Don't know how much it is. But.
Went round to Ricky's and had some chicken curry that Ricky's girlfriend Jane had made. Ricky and Jane were going on holiday for a few days and had arranged for Glyn to come in and make sure the cat was okay while they were away. I'm sick of that cat. I was surprised that they hadn't paid for the little shit to go away with them on first class. Blimey, getting a bit vitriolic in the
Why doesn't he like the fact that I've got a cat and I love the cat? Why?
It's just everything in that house that you've got gets sort of special treatment and it's a cat. And it
what do you mean
you
get special treatment?
Sometimes
we put food down for it, and sometimes it gets on our lap, and we stroke it.
You don't just stroke it. You massage its back. You know, you stressed out.
Well, no, it's good. I'm not saying you stressed out. At no point did I say you stressed out. You said, "What the fuck are you doing for? Is it stressed out or something?" I like touching my cat.
To be honest with you, I don't like Ricky's cat.
I can't believe this.
Every time I go around there, it comes straight from the coolies.
it's like the lizard thing you've got. It's just sat there. You've bought it a big box, right, to be in.
Right, it's a salamander, right. So it's an amphibian. Yeah. It's not a box, it's a big vivarium.
Yeah, but what I'm saying
if you're going to criticise someone for just sitting there, having a round head and doing nothing with its life, people who live in glass houses, we've done this one.
Do you know what gets me, though, right, Steve? When I was there, I was looking at it, and I thought, is it dead, right? So he's just sat there. Like,
and then it was thinking exactly the same fucking thing.
It sat there, not moving, right? And then on the top of the box is like a box full of crickets and stuff. That's it. It's food.
Yeah.
Right? But they were more active than the thing that it was going to feed. Get rid of the lizard. Keep them in there. More entertaining. Don't understand it.
A few months back, a girl who was having a kid showed me one of them scans of the kid that was in her. That's science gone mad, innit? I couldn't think of anything nice to say as it looked like a frog.
Do you know why we've got to that point?
What?
Why have we got to see something that young? Why?
Because people can keep an eye on the progress of the baby in the womb.
Yeah, but why are they printing it out and stuff? Surely that's for a doctor to see.
Well, that's just an added bonus for people who are interested in such things.
That's like saying, why do you take pictures of anything?
No, but what I mean is, why? At what point are we going to stop? Are we going to start sort of x-raying the fella's testicles and saying, well, there it is at a really young age? Well, where are we going to stop?
It's just horses for courses, isn't it? Some people like to have a record of their baby in the womb.
That's right.
To show their baby. They're excited about it.
They sit down and they show the friends the slideshow. That's the birth. Oh, that's the conception. Oh, look, Ron's going a bit mad there, isn't he?
But why do I need to see this? This is what I'm saying. It was an awkward situation because she was happy with it. I was like, Oh, God. You know what I mean? It was an odd looking thing. I couldn't say, oh, it looks like you, because that would be a diss. Speaking of flies, though, and that, they've got one, right? I was out with Ricky, right, and he was reading the paper. There was a story there about a fly that its eyesight was bad or something, and they've made it a pair of glasses, and it had a picture of a housefly wearing...
Okay, this is incredible, glasses. Steve. Can I take over?
Hang on, let me just need to finish a couple of questions for that. So he's got... There's a small fly, and they've made it a pair of glasses.
Yeah.
So that it can see better.
Yeah.
And your concern is what?
Well, again, it's just that thing of... We're looking after everything now, aren't we?
Sorry, I've got to come in here, Steve.
All right.
I showed you the story.
You saw it.
It was a picture of a housefly with a pair of glasses
on.
Yep. Right? It was about a one-sentence thing. Mm. It was about how far technology's come.
Yeah.
And a group of scientists using microscopy, right, and laser tools had, as an exhibition, shown that they could make a pair of glasses smaller to fit on a house. They put it on there and they've taken a picture of it and it's on display. At no point was it actually, because the fly had bad eyesight, the fly was presumably dead, it was purely an art installation or a show of technology.
I thought you were going to say, Rick, that you'd drawn the glasses on there.
Yeah.
And they believed it, like, there's a bearded lady in this paper. No. Yeah. Oh my God, Tony Blair looks like Adolf Hitler. No.
What do you think of that, though?
But they did it as an experiment.
Out. Yeah, but all things start as an experiment.
But why would they make a pair of glasses for a fly?
How would they know he had a bad eyesight?
How would they know it was the same fly?
Bumping into stuff. I don't know.
Bumping into stuff.
It's just that thing, innit, of human nature is something's wrong with something, let's fix it. And they try and help people out all the time, don't they?
When no! You know,
we are. We're always doing it. We're always trying to help people out instead of just going... You've been dealt a duff card. Cope with it. Came up with a good idea.
We'll be the judge of that.
Mm. I'll do it now. It's not a good idea.
Okay.
Okay. I'm sticking my neck out here. I think this isn't going to be a good idea.
Okay.
Thoughts?
Well, I'm going to agree with you. I'm going to second that motion.
Okay, let's see if we're both right.
See-through skin.
High five, Rick!
Why are they hanging about around there? Why aren't seals going, do you know what, it's cold, I'm sick of it here. It's windy all the time, what have you, and I'm getting a club on the head. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because they're meant to be quite bright in terms of animals and that, aren't they?
Yeah.
So why are they knocking about them parts?
I don't know.
Say, like, if seals... died out, right? Would that be a problem?
We've done this.
We've been through this before, Carl.
Everything has a knock-on effect.
Even a seal, that's sort of in between something already. It's between a fish and a
and a dog,
innit?
I knew you were going to say dog.
It's not between a fish and a dog. What do you think evolution does?
Understand it. Maybe
what do you mean it's between a fish and a dog?
I'm just saying it's...
It was a perfectly evolved mammal that re-entered the water, I imagine, and then got streamlined and it... I mean, it's between a fish and a dog.
But why not have one and the other? Why not have, like, you know, you've got a dog, you've got a fish.
No, it's not between a fish and a dog. It's not between a fish and a dog. I don't know what between means. I don't know what...
This is it again about saving everything all the time. What is it doing? What's it doing? Everyone's feeling sorry for him all the time. Save the seal and all that. What's it doing? Why are we saving it? Let's just ask that question. What's it doing?
I don't know what to say. It's between a fish and a dog. Problem, wouldn't it?
We're changing everything all the time, aren't we? I mean, there's some fella who was looking at on the internet. Identical twins, right? They were sort of sick of looking like each other. So they were like, what can we do, right? And one of the twins said, you have my arm, right? And he had his arm taken off and stuck on his twin, so his twin's got, like, three arms.
No, it's not true.
It's on the website.
No, it's not
what?
True.
What, for a laugh? They were born, so they did that for a laugh?
What doctor's doing this, then?
Well, they're old enough to sort of say, this is what we want, and...
No. Doctors don't go, well, if he wants another arm and I'll take... Doctors don't do that. What sort of practice is this doctor going around and go,
Dr. Jekyll?
I mean, Carl, think of what you're saying.
But
where would he have stopped? Can you put his head on my knee? It's up to you.
No,
sign this. If you sign this, give my consent.
But we, you know, it isn't.
What do you think these doctors are doing?
Just to do as they're told.
They don't do as they're told.
They do if someone wants it, and twins sort of, it can get you down, can't it? Being a twin, because it's like.
Sorry, what would this solve though? I thought you said he gave one of them a bigger nose or a beard or two front teeth to make him look different, right? Not. I'll tell you what we could do. Go on. Would you like one arm? Go on, what are you thinking? Well, me three, you one, therefore not twins.
Novelty.
I mean, you are a mental man.
But they can do it now, can't they? There's no sort of, there's no line drawn anymore. They don't go, you're crazy, we're not going to do that.
Yeah, in Saw 2, not in the real world. No, they don't do things like
all
this.
Right, there's another bloke, right? I don't know the sort of full ins and outs of it.
Go on, you surprise me.
But what he asked for, something happened to his tackle.
His penis.
So he was at the doctor's and they were like, oh, what can you do for me? It's a bit embarrassing, I've got nothing down there, right? So they were like looking at it going, yeah. Doctor, I don't know if he started like rubbing his chin with his finger or something. Looked down, he's thinking, got an idea. You know, you've got a lot of fingers. How many of them do you use? The patient's like, yeah, I see what you're thinking. They cut off one of his fingers, sewn that on to where his tackle is. He's happy.
Well, that's different though, isn't it? Well, that's where they've
really
taken
different.
Tissue. No, but I assume they fashioned it into more of a knob than a finger.
If you were doing that, use a sausage. I mean, why lose a finger?
Well, I'll tell you why. Because your finger has your tissue, your blood type, and therefore would graft to neotesticles. A sausage is a thing that's made by a butcher out of offal, okay, that really can't be grafted onto any part of the human body. That's why they very rarely use any meat products in surgery. I know, yeah. Why not use a sausage? You're a mental case.
I always remember this story when I was a kid about some bloke. He had throat cancer, right? And his doctor said, carry on with your life, right? It's not going to be that good, but just carry on. But don't eat meat. And he was like, oh, I love meat. He's like, yeah, but just don't, you know, have your veg, keep yourself strong, but don't be eating that. Anyway, he was fed up because he loved his meat. And his wife was feeling a bit sorry for him one day. And thought, you know, I'm sick of him looking fed up and that. All he wants is some meat, for God's sake, give him some meat. So she goes to the butcher's, gets him a big piece of, like, steak and what have you. He can't believe it. He's like, oh, brilliant, cheers for that. Anyway, he's got the meat on his plate, just about to tuck in, and the cancer comes out from his throat.
What?
No, it's something, I know, it sounds really weird, but it's something that I was told about years ago when I was growing up.
What are you talking about?
It was just some bad illness, some cancer thing, and it sort of, it was coming out waiting for the meat. It was sort of dying.
Again, a lot of your medical knowledge is from...
It's from the film Alien.
So this guy with throat cancer, okay, yeah. As opposed to it being a disease of the cell...
It was like a living...
The alien.
It was the animal... It was the little animal cancer.
That's why.
What are you talking about?
He wasn't allowed to eat meat.
So it's sitting there. So it's actually sitting there and throwing. Why? I'll tell you what I'd have done if I'd have had some cancer in my throat. I'd go, there you go. Rid of that. What are you talking about? So what happened?
He choked to death on this thing, and the wife was like, "Oh, I shouldn't give him the meat after all." Just
that's
listen
a bollock
to you.
Story.
It's all. There's loads of weird stuff like that.
There
that
is.
Happens in medical stuff.
Well, the terrible thing is, if you got testicular cancer and you eat meat, your bollocks come out of your trousers and they're all over the plate,
yeah.
And you have to be asked to leave the restaurant.
Get straight into it. A band from the Conga have won the best newcomers in a Radio 3 competition. They use pots and pans for instruments. It says that the Conga is a poor, sad place. So why do people do that happy dance at the end of parties called the Conga?
Right, one is the Congo. There's no place called the Conga. They come from a place called the Congo.
Conga!
Get out!
Met Suzanne at Euston Station. I said I would sort out the tea tonight, so I called the curry house. The fella couldn't understand me. I asked for two poppadoms. He kept saying, how many? I kept saying two. He still couldn't understand. I said one more than one. He understood. When we picked up the food and took it home, there were five poppadoms in the bag. There is a restaurant somewhere that sells knobs to eat.
No, there's not.
There is.
No, there's not.
No, there is.
It says that women can't eat too many of them, and if you want a seal's knob for dinner, you have to book in advance.
Right, it's gobbledygook. This is the ramblings of a madman again.
It's a trend, he writes. It won't last long. It'll be like hummus. Called Ricky and asked what the difference is between the mind and the brain.
Yeah, he did.
That's a hell of a phone call to get.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Ricky did explain, but I can't remember what he said. I wondered at what age you are when the mind kicks in. Okay. Ricky changed the subject and said there is an island called Spider Island. There's nothing but spiders on it. A bloke went to visit the island and said there was 1,000 types of spider in one tree.
What do you think about that? What do you think about an island that's just full of spiders?
I don't know, because you need spiders. I don't know what they do, but they say a world without spiders... like wouldn't be good, but they sort of do something. There's something about if you did get rid of them all, it would have an effect.
Well, of course it would. Any get rid of anything, it would have an effect.
Not everything though. Like I've said, you know, jellyfish and what have you.
Well, no,
it's 97% water or something.
Yeah.
So how much are they doing? Just give them another 3%, make them water. And that's more useful.
Give them another 3% and make them water. Oh, God.
Went into the gadget shop today. It's full of stuff that we don't need. Gadget used to be a good word that made you think of James Bond with all his gadgets. The best thing I could find in the shop was a clock that ran on potatoes. We are definitely going backwards.
I agree. Well, what's the... who cares about that? A little... electrical impulse, so what?
Had a night out with old schoolmate. Found out about more of the other lads I went to school with. One is living underground.
What do you mean living underground? Not like a mole. Do you mean he's got a basement, or do you mean he digs a hole every night?
My mate went to visit him and he said it had been raining really heavily and that, and it's all the rain's running in.
What do you mean he went to visit him? He went down here? What's that? That's an hole in the ground. Yeah, come in.
He just said, oh, come round to us, and he's living underground.
What do you mean he's living underground?
He's happy down there. He said it was really muddy and what have you. He said he won't be going back to visit him.
I believe this, though. I believe someone he went to school with now lives in a hole. That doesn't shock me. That's
he spent far too long with him, if that. Now you're just happy to accept.
I totally accept that. I'd be surprised if I walked round where he lived that there weren't more people living in holes. His dad wanted to throw his budgie on the fire.
True.
His budgie died, his dad said, let's throw it on the fire. I mean, his mum, what did your mum do?
She just was worried about the other bird that was left, so she made it a bit of company by getting a rock, getting a feather off the dead budgie, sticking it on the rock, putting it in the cage.
So, a man living in a hole is not that bizarre. Alright, carry on.
Watched a film about Hitler. Didn't watch all of it as it was subtitled. Can't be doing with that. Asked Suzanne if cinemas are full of deaf people when they're showing subtitled films. She said, shh, I'm trying to watch it. I say, what do you mean, shh? It's subtitled, I can make as much noise as I want.
Yeah.
She's a lucky, lucky woman.
You must be a joy to watch a subtitled film. I mean, the concentration is up there already. It's not as easy as when you're hearing it, because, you know, you read things, but, you know, it's possible. If you had a buffoon going, I'm just going to sit here and make as much noise as I want, what's the point of that?
Yeah.
Do that in a cinema. Just walk into a subtitled film and go, right, everybody, let's all do the Congo.
We're having our bathroom done. The bathroom man was around at 9 this morning. We weren't allowed to use the shower because it all had to be bone dry before we could use his waterproof filler. Not that waterproof then. Went for a brew with Ricky. We talked about monkeys and how they are closer to humans than they are to apes and how bees will drink cider to get off their heads. Now and again there is a bee that lets the drinking get in the way of the work and other bees sting it to death. Blimey.
Yeah, well, there are bees. They love a drink. They will drink pure alcohol. They love getting off it and they fall down and they're drunk, right? But some bees
get addicted in the same sort of percentage as human addiction, like 10% of bees, they can't get enough of it. They take ethanol, they take cider apples and that. And then when they get back to the hive, they go in a bit pissed and they've got guard bees and they go, come on, we've all had a drink. Yeah, they sort of are, right? And they push them away and they push them away again. Then the next time they go, right, I've had enough. And they give it a good hiding. And Karl couldn't get over this. I saw his face. But I knew that he was thinking of that bee with sort of like eyes rolling around his head, a little bit belligerent with his jacket on backwards.
Yeah.
You know, and the bouncer going, come on, come on, son, we've all had enough. Let's move away, yeah. Move away.
You're not coming in, right? You're wearing trainers.
Yeah, you know, you're wearing three pairs of trainers. I'm sick of it, you know.
But what I did find out, because I went home and went on the computer trying to find out about drunk bees knocking about, they're not actually meant to fly. It's only because they don't know. Well, no, but they're if they were told that you're not actually designed to fly, they wouldn't bother.
No, this is that thing that goes around that aerodynamically, on the face of it, looking at the size of the wings and the body proportions and everything, that it's a surprise that they can fly. Okay, it's not that. No one's ever told them they can't, and as soon as someone tells me not meant to fly, they all fall out of the sky going, oh, what are we doing? Like in a cartoon.
No, but it's something about the confidence and that. At the moment, nobody's saying
to it's nothing to do with the confidence. There is no such thing as confidence in bees. A bee never loses his nerve. That's not why it drinks. Because what are you drinking for? I'm just not confident anymore. There's no point to turn to the bottle. I can't go up there again. You're an idiot. Here's an interesting fact. If the frog annoyed you, this might annoy you. A blind chameleon will still change colour to match its surroundings. You're aware that the chameleon can...
Yeah, whatever it sits on.
Yeah.
But then what happens when you put one of them on a mirror? No, does it get stressed out or what? What's it copying?
Well, it probably doesn't need to copy anything because it looks at itself and it goes, oh, looks like that's brilliant. God, that was fast. That's the fastest I've ever done that. That is brilliant.
So they can go any colour. There's nothing. You can put them on anything and they'll go to the thing.
I don't want you to have a chameleon because you'd just be trying to see what it could and couldn't
do.
Try
and catch it out.
Oh, no, yeah.
Pop it on some tartan.
Yeah. But again, say like the frog thing, right?
Pop it on the telly.
Yeah.
Couldn't do it fast enough.
Why does the chameleon need that skill of copying a colour? Because at the end of the day, that's mainly sticking in the woods, isn't it? By trees, by grass.
Right.
Why can't it just stay green? That's all it needs. Those colour changes are only for camouflage, aren't they?
I don't know. Some of them are for attraction. Some of them to show moods, anger.
No, but I just think we're encouraging them. You see, maybe this is evolution or whatever. But at the end of the day, because they can change colour... They're wandering out of their area. They can be wandering about, you know, through a car park and everything, just because they'll go, well, I don't want to get seen, change the colour of concrete. Whereas...
Or into the colour of a Fiat Punto.
But they should just stay green. Stay green, right? Stay in the woods and stay safe.
I love this public information for chameleons.
Words of advice for chameleons.
Oh, God.
Stay green, stay in the woods, stay safe. Good night.
Oh, God.
Right. The only time a turkey whistles is when it panics.
Christmas time, then.
Yeah. What do you think of that, Karl?
It goes from one extreme to another, doesn't it? You've got a frog who's going mental.
It's not going mental.
Killing thousands of people.
No, that's not...
That's got that sort of power. Then you've got a turkey who's whistling for help.
You think that you should redress the balance a little bit? You want to give... What would you do? Give the frog the ability to kill 500 and the turkey 500?
I don't think it should be killing, I reckon 10. 10, because...
You've made your point with 10, haven't you?
Do you think that he's got 1,000 in his lifetime, like he's got 1,000 to kill? I don't think you understand.
I just think...
He doesn't really kill 1,000 people. It doesn't mean someone goes, Frog, you have the power to kill 1,000 people in your lifetime.
Choose them wisely.
But I just think if it needs that sort of power...
It should be fighting evil?
Well, it's not... it's knocking about the wrong area, isn't it? If it's under that much danger, move. I was thinking the other day about, you know, your body and everything, because it is amazing, isn't it? How it works.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Does the brain control you, or are you controlling the brain? I don't know if I'm in charge of mine.
Nor do I,
there's
Carl.
A surprise.
Nor do I, Carl.
No, do you know what I mean, though, by that?
Does the brain control you, or do
you
control the brain?
Like, don't you ever sort of think sometimes? Say if you're making...
But you are the brain.
No, but I was making a shopping list, right? Going, right, I need some rice, kidney beans, and I thought I had everything, and I sort of was rolling up the paper, and then something went, oh, an onion.
Your brain
did that. Something went, an onion. Was it Suzanne?
No, well, my brain sort of went, you forgot something.
Yeah.
I didn't think I'd forgot. I was
are your brain.
No, but don't you understand? I was in control of my brain when I was writing down rice and kidney beans.
But you're not in charge of the onion. That's another part of the brain that's in charge of the onion.
The onion sector. Yeah.
No, but I put the paper away, putting my coat on, ready to go and get the rice.
Yes, but your onion lobe kicked in.
What, so you put the paper in your pocket, you got the coat on, then you just suddenly hear from nowhere.
Then it was just like, onion. Like, yeah, I'm not even thinking about that shopping list. It's in my pocket, I'm thinking, do I need my gloves, it's cold out.
Yeah.
Suddenly, onion. And it was like, oh yeah, onion, yeah, I had to get the paper out. So what I'm saying is, who's in charge?
The brain is the... What are you doing? Who's in charge?
That's just, you forgot the onion, then you remembered the onion. You must have forgotten things in the past.
No, but not like that. Not where... Like, it just made me think, that was weird. Who reminded me of that?
You did.
Yeah, but I'm not...
No, you are your brain. It's not like there's you, then there's a brain, then there's an extra one looking down at it. Oh, the meta brain, the thing above it.
No, but your brain... How does your brain work? You give it information, don't you?
Well, it takes.
Do you mean you give it information?
Well, if I sat in a room with nothing, not feeding it anything, it wouldn't know anything.
No, but there's two yous. It's this thing that there's.
There's Carl and Carl's brain.
Yeah, there's not a duality in this. If you go, come on, now think. That's the brain saying that to itself. It's not. There's not two people in there having an argument. Coming, come on, brain. And the brain's going, oh, don't you start. I was thinking then. And the other thing's going, brain, onion. And the brain goes, Carl, onion. You are your brain. If you are anything, you are your mind, your brain, your collection of memories, your personality. You're not what you look like. Does that answer your question, Carl? What do you think are then? You were thinking of a tortoise on a skateboard then when I said that last sentence, weren't you?
Not your own.
I'm not being funny though, so if you have a body transplant, right? And you're there, you're at home, naked, you look down, lovely penis and a set of testicles.
Yeah.
Right? What do you do with them?
What do you mean, what am I doing with them?
Well, do you like them?
Well, you wouldn't mess about with them as much as if they were your own.
But if you did mess about them, would you feel guilty that you were messing about with another man's testicles and penis?
And it's the full body?
Yeah.
No, because they're not my hands either.
So what you're doing is watching someone else wank.
Yeah. That's the ever-changing jingle for Carl's diary, excerpts of which we like to read each week. Walk through Covent Garden. There were five of them mimes knocking about. I don't understand why people take pictures of mimes. Everyone looks like a mime in a picture.
That's so true. That's really true. If the point is they're staying still, if that's their skill, a picture won't tell that story. That's absolutely true.
My dad took the cat to be put down today because it kept bumping into things since losing its sight. My mum said she's not going to get another one. She said the parrot is looking worried as it's seen the budgie and the cat go in the space of 3 months.
Your mum said the parrot's looking worried. What's the what happened to the cat then?
It gets into a lot of fights. It lost one eye, and then it got into another fight, lost another.
Oh,
and
no.
It was just walking around, bumping into stuff. I mean, the vet sort of said, oh, we can do stuff to keep it alive and all that, but it's a bit out of order, isn't it? Because it costs a fortune. They shouldn't tell you.
But
Mum and Dad can't afford to have eyes put on it and stuff.
No, you can't have eyes put on a cat
anyway. No, but they said, oh, we can do something here. We can have its eyes sorted out.
But it I don't think you should be allowed cats.
Why?
Not the Pilkington family.
Why not? Well, they have good lives. Yeah, I know, but they have good lives whilst they're still knocking about. It's just that we get through them.
It's a good job you're not going to have kids.
Oh, God almighty. I can't believe it.
A mate sent me a story on email about a bloke in China who has this weird illness that means he can't have his picture taken. That's not the weird bit. If he tries, his body doesn't appear in the photo.
Don't talk shit.
He has had group pictures taken and everyone appeared apart from him.
Don't talk shit.
The
That's
story
bollocks.
Had a picture next to it of a family photo and it said he was stood at the back, but you couldn't see him.
Right. He wasn't in the picture.
He was in the picture.
No, he wasn't in the picture.
He's done loads of tests and stuff.
No, I haven't done loads of tests. This is bollocks. There's no way this is scientifically possible. What's his want? Yeah, now he's wanted. Just a white bit of paper up on the police wall. Have you seen this man? What man? If you see him, tell us. You're talking shit.
Spoke to Ricky about trips to the moon. Oh. He was up for going just to see what the world looks like. I came up with the idea of a giant mirror on the moon that would reflect the world back. He had a few questions, but I had the answers.
Yeah.
He changed the subject, I won.
Right. My first question was, how would you get it up there? He said, bit by bit. That'd be a good mirror then, wouldn't it? I said, how big would it be? He went, you'd still need a telescope. I said, how would you get it on the right side of the moon, always facing the right? He went, what? He went, does the moon move then? I went, yes.
And if we don't like the mirror on the moon, we can always wallpaper over it. It's Suzanne's birthday tomorrow, so I've got to get her something. I sometimes think it would be best if we didn't celebrate birthdays. I think people would live a bit longer if they didn't know how old they were. Age puts restrictions on things. She said something about wanting one of them posh badges to put on her coat. I will look for one later.
I love the fact that around the time that you've got to buy Suzanne her birthday present, you think that birthday presents are a bad idea.
Got up early, it's Suzanne's birthday, gave her the card and present. She was well happy with her posh badge. She wore it to work. It's quite nice to hear a moment where she was actually happy for once in your company. They always say when you get someone a present, you should buy them something they wouldn't buy themselves. Daft rule. I want something I would buy myself if I had the money. When I was young, me auntie Nora got me a present I wouldn't buy myself. It was a t-shirt with her face on.
We've been away filming in a sweltering London. We've had a heat wave here in the capital city, haven't we, Carl?
It's been hot, right?
Been up to 100 degrees, record-breaking temperatures.
Yeah.
What have you been doing, though?
Getting to see the place, having loads of walks. And I like to have walks. You know, watching what
like
people
a dog.
Are
yeah! When he jumps off the couch and starts exactly. scratching against the door.
Suzanne thinks it's time.
It's just good thinking time, though, isn't it? As well, having a walk. You've got no other clutter going on around you. And right. you just think about a lot of stuff. And, you know, like say, with the weather being hot and stuff, a lot of insects knocking about.
Right.
So I've just been watching them.
So while we've been filming, you've been watching insects?
Yeah, just seeing, because everybody knows insects are out there, but no one's keeping an eye on them.
What are they up to? What are you worried about?
Loads of Steve, you wouldn't be laughing like that if you'd watch them, because they do some weird stuff and that, yeah. is what I mean.
What yeah. sort of stuff? Any examples?
I saw a bee have a heart attack.
You saw a bee have a heart attack?
Yeah.
How were you sure it was a heart attack?
Because what happened, I'd been...
Did it clutch its chest with all six legs?
No,
were there some other little bee paramedics?
No, I'd just been out in the park anyway, just looking at, you know, caterpillars knocking about. Butterflies and stuff, so I was sort of aware.
So when Suzanne goes to work, she goes, Carl, don't you waste the day. I want you to do some constructive stuff.
But the thing is, so I'd been in the park and I was aware of the insects that are around us more than, like, most of the time. And I come out of the park, just crossing, like, a sort of a busy road and what have you, and I saw this bee to the right of me, sort of in the air, and it was a big one, and I was a bit like, oh, let's watch that. And, it just fell. It fell from the air in front of me, and it was on the pavement. I thought, oh, what's going on here? And I looked at it for a bit, and it was really still. Gave it a little kick, just to see if there was any movement. Nothing. Stone, sort of, what's the saying? Stone cold dead.
Stone cold be dead.
So, yeah. That
I like the fact that this bee suddenly saw Carl and had a heart attack.
Yeah.
It'd never seen anything that round before. Yeah. It just thought, it had approached him because he thought it was a sunflower.
My God, it's a giant walking orange. Every dream has come true.
No, but it just summed up life for me. I thought, that's like us, isn't it, at the end of the day? They have heart attacks, stress.
You put it down to stress, do you?
Well, it's in London, isn't it? You know, everything has stresses from living here.
And they are bald, aren't they? They've got fur all over, but they lose the...
I'm always overweight.
It was a fat, bald bee.
So what did you... It fell to the floor and you instantly... You just kicked it. You didn't attempt to revive it.
No, I waited a second and just looked at it to see if there was any, you know, leg movement or wing. And there was nothing. And then when I sort of kicked it, it was sort of hard. It had hardened already. It's just
rigor mortis
set in.
So it put you in a bad mood for the day, because I know things like that can just send you over the edge for the day.
Death and that does a bit. Suzanne doesn't like me talking about death.
What riveting conversations do you come up with?
No, just things like one of our mates has had a baby recently, and I just was saying, when that's sort of our age, we'll nearly be dead.
Think of that.
That's the first thing he says, is a new life brought into the world.
I know.
But when he's our age, we'll be dead.
Yeah.
No,
maybe
weird.
They'll let you do the speech at the christening.
Well, yeah, I've been watching loads of stuff. I've been watching ants. You mentioned ants. I've had a lot of moths in the house. They're sort of sad.
I mean, you say it like it was a garden party.
Yeah, well, but all I'm saying is I look at more about what its life is like. Because if you watch something long enough, is what I'm saying, you can see that it's a bit clueless. It's the same way about ants, or, you know, they're hard workers and all that. I watch one, it's going back and forth all the time. They go one way and then they stop and go the other way. They try to look busy in front of the mates. But if you watch one, if you watch one long enough, it's back and forwards and it's like it's done nothing there.
I'm going to carry this twig back and forth until I can knock off at four.
There's a lot of that going on.
Is there?
Because there's not. There's none of that going on.
There is. No, like I say, the moth. Depressing little sort of thing.
Why is it depressing?
It hasn't got eyes, has it? You just look at it, and it doesn't know what's going on. I just don't I think if you haven't got eyes, you shouldn't have wings.
That's a rule, if we could put that into practice, please.
That's a great rule. That's a fantastic rule, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you haven't got eyes, you shouldn't have wings.
You know, when you see them in films, they're running about and that, and everybody likes an octopus. But this one that's on the... It was your fault, really, because you told me about that frog that's going about killing people.
No, I didn't say that.
So I looked it up on the internet at, like, other creatures and stuff. And
com.
there's some octopus that's in the sea. And what it does, you don't even have to, like, threaten it. It just spits in the water. And if that stuff gets on you, does you in.
Again, I'm...
So in a way, it's good knowledge because... I mean, I don't go in the sea anyway because it's full of stuff like that. But that's just reassured me that I'm doing the right thing. If they're knocking about, just gozzing everywhere, you don't even have to be near one. You don't even know if it's been spitting and stuff. It can kill you. It just seems unfair. I haven't harmed it. I haven't gone near it. Why is it getting annoyed with me? Doesn't seem right. So that's where a knowledge has not helped that octopus out. Because now, when you eat them, I just think, yeah, have another one. Do you know what I mean? Get rid of them.
Another conversation with himself. Another conversation with himself. Okay, Carl, I'm just going to throw an animal at you. Tell me how weird it is, what bits annoy you, how you change it, okay? A crab.
I would have changed it.
Yeah. Does it annoy you? Do you think it's weird?
They are weird. But they're at that size where they can get away with it.
Yeah, it suits them. Okay, good.
Would have changed anything? In a way, you know, what you're saying about things not working, he can't walk forwards. But why hasn't something happened? Why haven't they said, you know what, these arms are too clumsy? We need to have them so they can slot away easier and we can pull them out when we need them. Instead of clumping around with them. Because they do struggle. You see them struggling with their arms. Yeah, they're still here. They're still doing that. They're still designed that way.
What's the weirdest animal? So you think the octopus is the weirdest animal on Earth?
Yeah.
Why is it any weirder than a dog?
Because it couldn't be further away from us. A dog has got human eyes. If a jellyfish had a pair of eyes like ours, I probably wouldn't worry about him that much. But like I said to you, it's that way that they haven't got eyes, they're floating about. I can handle some fish. They look like they've got eyes. You can make eye-to-eye contact with them. What are you looking at? It's a snidey thing, like I've said to you. You can see a lot in eyes. Do you know what I mean? You say, don't trust him. Why? It's his eyes. Jellyfish haven't even got any, and I don't trust them. In terms of design and everything, and if you lined everything up, say if I'd come from another planet and everything was lined up in a row, and they said, right, we're going to give you a crash course in what's knocking about on this planet.
Yeah.
And you go, right, go on then. And you go, this is man, here's woman, here's a dog, here's a cat, here's an octopus, here's a... I go, hang on a minute, what is this? Say if everything was at the same size as us, what would be the best thing to be? Say like a tarantula.
Yeah.
And a tiger. What would happen there?
So a 15 stone tiger versus a 15 stone tarantula.
Yeah.
Well, I can imagine a 15 stone tarantula.
Right, so it's just weird that, innit? It's a good job that they're small. Yet things are getting bigger because we're messing with the world.
But it's a ridiculous thing to say, isn't it? Because what would it eat? 15 stone. The biggest you'll find is like a foot long beetle or something.
It's
like
big though, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's about as big as they get.
He's gonna
I wouldn't
kill
worry
that.
About it.
Mm.
Again, based on nothing, he queries you.
But it's like fish, isn't it? How they say about a goldfish.
Yeah.
That thing about a woman who went on holiday and stuck it in a bath.
Mm.
She came back, it was 7 foot.
Right, that didn't happen.
No, that's a well-known thing about goldfish.
No, it's
goldfish.
Not a well-known thing.
What?
I'll tell you why. Because a fish will only grow to its surroundings anyway. So...
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
You have to put it in a bigger tank.
Yeah, in a bath.
No, a 7 foot fish in a bath. It just fit the bath exactly, did it?
When she got back of holiday.
Don't talk shit. It's what was it eating? What was it eating?
How long was she gone for? 2 million years?
Yeah. She went to Mars and back.
Ted, you're not going to believe this. Come up here.
Well, how many fish do you see that have naturally died? It's always been caught by a man or a shark's at it. You don't just see dead fish washed up. Here.
Well, most things that don't die of old age.
Yeah, that's weird, though, isn't it?
Well, no, because it's a, you know, it's a jungle out there.
No, worse than the sea. The sea is like full of. You've got an enemy around every rock.
I love it. I love it. I love it's like a warning to crabs and young squid. It's like the policeman that comes into your school.
Yeah. Carl, have you ever seen the programme Inside the Actors Studio?
No.
James Lipton interviews famous actors and gets words of advice about, you know, how they work and how they act. But at the end, he always asks a series of questions, which is based on a French series of questions that a guy called Bernard Pivot used to give people when he interviewed them. So I'm going to ask you some of these questions, just interesting to see what your response is. And, you know, answer them quickly. You don't have to think about them too much.
Hmm.
What is your favourite curse word?
I don't think I've got one. Knobhead. That sums everything up, and I think it's...
But you wouldn't call your nan a knobhead, would you? What would you call a nan?
Well, yeah. Knobhead's all right, isn't it? Because she sort of gets it. It's one of them things that everybody understands, but it's not too offensive.
Right.
What a knobhead.
What would you do, though, if you were swimming, right? It was a nice little thing, you were on holiday, right? And there's this octopus there, and you're going around, right? And you just see it start spitting at you, poison. What would you say to it?
Well, it's too late then, isn't it? And I'd kick it. And I'd say, knobhead. I would, but what's the point? What's the point in getting annoyed now? Because it's done its stuff, hasn't it?
He's kicking a queer knobhead under the water. What is this octopus thinking? Oh, God! Oh, I'd go, you fucking eight-legged shit.
I'm not bothered. I don't know what you're saying.
Fucking...
fucking cunt of a mollusk.
I just spit at you again. It's not bothered.
You slimy little fucking boneless wanker.
This is why the face
Are you
is
still
good.
Talking to the octopus? That jingle, of course, signifies another reading from Karl Pilkington's diary. We went to the park and had a brew. Suzanne read the paper while I played with a ladybird. I mean, it's like a child, isn't it? It is like what a child would do.
Suzanne read the paper while I played with a ladybird. His only friend is a beetle.
It climbed up my arm. It struggled on me hairs.
This is in detail, then.
Yeah. It kept stopping every now and then and was rubbing its head with its right arm. It did it about 4 times and always used its right arm. It rested for about 5 minutes, then flew off. Sunday. Had a bit of a to-do with Suzanne because she wanted a lion today. I ate this. Once you're awake, you should get up. I got up and put the radio on really loud. She eventually got up. I told her insects don't have lions, so we shouldn't.
Obsessed with insects.
You must be fucking unbearable to live with. You must be a nightmare.
No, I've just started, because I've watched insects a lot, I don't want to keep going on about them because we're a bit insect heavy. But at the end of the day, if we copied insects, we wouldn't go far wrong.
I don't know what you mean, though. 1 minute you're saying they're great, then the next minute you'll slag them off.
Yeah, I'll slag some of them off if I don't know what they're doing, but because I've studied them a bit longer, I just think they do.
You haven't
right.
studied them, though.
He thinks he's like Darwin.
But you just slagged him off when again. Don't you think that insects are doing stuff? They're not. It goes there, then it goes back again.
The ant was messing about. But only that one, the others were carrying stuff. That's what I'm saying. These snidey ones in everything. In everything in the world, you get a hierarchy.
Oh, long words!
Ooh. Some new sea thing has been found.
That's the headlines on the news.
It wasn't found by sea experts. It was found on eBay. Someone was selling it for a fiver. I don't see the point in buying something that you don't know what it is.
What do you mean? It was...
Someone's found some sort of shell with a thing living in it.
Right.
They thought, oh, I've never seen one of these before. I can flog it on eBay. Someone bought it and then wanted to look after it, went to some sea expert, and they said, oh, I don't know what that is. That's the story. It's just weird how stuff's being found on eBay.
No, it wasn't found on eBay, though, was it?
Yeah, but that's where the specialist people sort of picked up on it. It's just weird that... I mean, all I was saying is I wouldn't want one. If you don't know how to... If it's a new creature, you don't know what makes it happy. When you get a kitten, you go, stroke its head, loves it, right? And you can do that knowing that it's liking it. If I had a little seashell and you go, does it sit in water? I don't know. Do you know what I mean? You could end up doing more damage. So that's why I wouldn't want it. It's nice to have rules, isn't it? It's nice to know what you're doing with something.
Well, as you write in the diary, it's like if an alien landed and wanted to live with you. As much fun as it might sound, it wouldn't be long before you got annoyed with it because it wouldn't eat the food you gave it.
That's what I'm saying, but I couldn't have a go at it because it might not like pasta.
It might not.
Everyone likes pasta.
Wow.
Woke up to some interesting news. It's good when this happens because it sets me up for the day ahead. If it's miserable news, it affects my day. It said on the news that they have found 2 new flies.
Fucking hell, more insects! What have you done? Is that all you've done this summer?
Bong. Trouble in the Middle East. Bong. 2 new flies found.
Ladybird climbs up arm.
They were found in the UK and they were found close to each other. Maybe this happened because they were different than the other flies and weren't expected to hang about together, so that's why they knocked about with each other.
That would happen, wouldn't it?
What do you mean?
It's 2 new flies.
What do you mean? Does it mean there are 2 new flies that are a different species?
Yeah, 2 new species, and they found them close to each other, right?
Yeah,
and
but they didn't mean there was one of each.
No. Yeah, they did. They found 2 different ones.
No,
they have. Seriously, I know that. That's right. That's a fact. So you've got, like, I don't know the names of them. They give them odd names, don't they? Well, say you call it A and Fly B, right?
Yeah.
Fly A, I don't know. Say that's orange.
This is just...
B. Fly B, yeah.
No, this is painful.
No,
this
but
is
I'm just
painful.
Making it easy.
But Fly B wears a little hat. He's got a little hat.
Right, yeah, fine. Now, they found the orange one. I went, look at this over there. this is a bit weird. And they've gone, oh, that's a new species, log it, whatever. And then the other one went, oh, keep your pen handy. Look at this one, it's got Aton. So then they found them both within the same distance.
I don't know what that sentence
keep
means.
Keep going.
They found them both within the same distance.
But without interrupting him, let him finish this point.
Let me just make one thing clear. Karl Pilkington just said, they found them both within the same distance.
Think of that!
Don't know what it means, but go on, let him finish this point.
So what I mean is, they weren't knocking about with other normal houseflies because they were probably sort of going, oh, he's a bit weird. Leave it. Yet, because the other one was also odd, they're hanging about with each other. Don't you understand that? Why is that such an odd concept?
Because you think of it as like two little new kids in school.
Yeah.
They find out they're both new and they've got something in common.
They're both goths, so they start hanging out together. And this was on the news, was it?
Yeah, just on the radio, yeah.
I know if I looked into that story, it would be 90% wrong.
Bit tired today because didn't get to sleep as early as I wanted due to a moth getting in the bedroom.
Fuck me!
I got it in a glass and looked at it for a bit and then let it go because Suzanne wanted to go to sleep. Looked up some interesting news. Some people dug up an old body in Ireland. Turns out it's well old and was here when dinosaurs were here. The really weird bit is it had hair gel in its hair.
Right, what is it?
A fella.
Well, no, it wasn't around when dinosaurs were here then.
Just a bit after.
Right, fine. A lot after, yeah, go on.
It's not the age bit, that's amazing. It's the fact of there's a fella, won't have even had shoes on his feet.
Right.
And yet he was worried about his hair style.
Right, well, that's definitely not true either.
There was a man on the radio doing poetry, says Karl in his diary. I thought I'd have a go at doing a poem about today.
Not really. Steve, I'm a little bit queasy. He hasn't really written a poem.
He's written a small poem.
No, he hasn't really.
Yes. If moths had eyes...
Fuck me!
let me read the poem, okay?
Oh, fuck.
He wouldn't interrupt T.S. Eliot.
Okay. Okay.
If moths had eyes, would they be happier? How do they know they're not dead? Cavemen hunting for food. But not before they style the hair on their head. What would last longer in dinosaur times? A blind man didn't stand a chance. Not with all them rocks about. I'd rather be a blind moth.
Right. It may be the greatest poem ever written.
Is there a creative decision for that?
Can we have Karl read that?
By
sorry.
Means, yes.
Just you read it as you would like to. So this is, imagine this, right? Okay. This is going out all over the world.
And now, Karl Pilkington, a new poet from Manchester, now living in London, England, would like to read a poem.
If moths had eyes, would they be happier? How do they know they're not dead? Cavemen hunting for food, but not before they style the hair on their head. What would last longer in dinosaur times? A blind man didn't stand a chance. Not with all them rocks about. I'd rather be a blind moth.
He said it as though the last bit was going to rhyme. He said it like it was going to rhyme. Oh, God.
No,
I
think he feels as though the final line, I'd rather be a blind moth, is going to be one of those great, you know, a summation that somehow the moth is a metaphor. The caveman.
No,
there's no metaphor in that. He really does mean he'd rather be a blind moth.
Yeah, well, I'm just because I've looked at the day's news.
Are you getting into poetry now, properly?
I really like it, yeah. Right, I did two about jellyfish.
Excellent.
I don't like jellyfish. They're not a fish, they're just a blob. They don't have eyes, fins, or scales like a cod. They float about blind, stinging people in the seas. And no one eats jellyfish with chips and mushy peas. Get rid of them. And then there's just a shorter one I did about a jellyfish. It would be spiteful to put jellyfish in a trifle.
Yeah, it certainly would.
That's great! That's really good! Because it's jelly. It's he's done us there, Steve.
Yeah.
That's
a
really good poem.
Can we always do that, Carl? Can we always find a day, right, and always sum it up in your thoughts, a poem, just like that? It would be spiteful to put jellyfish in a trifle.
Yeah. What's been going on?
I've been to hospital. I was rushed to hospital, right, emergency and that. Had a tube put on my knob.
You had a tube put up your knob?
Yeah.
What's the story?
Kidney stones.
Oof.
So, shouldn't really be here, to be honest, doing this. He said rest and that. Climbing them stairs on the way in.
To be quite honest, it doesn't look like you're expending a lot of energy at the moment. It's like at Zookeeper going, oh, that sloth move today. Calm down.
Yeah, but I had to get here. It's been raining.
Yeah.
I had to come up the stairs. I had to carry the computer.
Yeah.
Well, that's not entirely true because your girlfriend was carrying it. I saw her outside.
Yeah, but I'm just saying.
And then you handed it to me and said, Steve, carry this.
God almighty.
So.
Yeah, I know.
That's already a lie.
Christ almighty. Whinging.
Not whinging.
I'm in show business. I know loads of people that wake up every day with a sore knob, feeling like they've had their kidneys probed, and they will say they're unconscious. So they don't whinge about it. They get straight back onto it. They, you know, a lot of them are on TV now.
Yeah, straight back to hosting game shows.
So you're rushed to hospital.
So take us through the events, because it does sound quite dramatic. You started feeling a bit of pain, did you, initially?
I felt a bit of pain, and I thought, you know, maybe I just pulled a muscle or something when I've been wrestling with Ricky and that, because you don't know what damage has been done. So I just think, oh, it'll go in a minute, and then it didn't. It got a bit badder.
It got badder, did it?
So then I was crippled. I was lying on the floor in agony, looking on the internet. Looking for sort of
still
solutions.
Looking at monkey news.
I just put in like belly ache and stuff, and they were saying me loads of different things. And what I used to do when I was a kid, I used to always just get a cold ashtray and put that on my belly, and the coldness used to get rid of the badness.
Amazing.
The coldness got rid.
Well, like a witch doctor.
Yeah.
This is like
a witch doctor who happens to work in a pub.
It's like some sort of 5th century remedy.
Yeah.
Written in mud. Yeah. Coldness doth get away with the badness.
Yeah. Why specifically an ashtray?
Just because they were at the sort of old cold.
They're old cold.
I don't know what this is. I love this idea that he's at the operation and he comes round and they're talking to him and his girlfriend gets a phone call and they say, Mr. Pilkington's maybe complications, he's just talking rubbish. Yeah, she goes, oh good.
Yeah, he's back to his old self. Yeah. Why specifically an ashtray? Sorry, because it's old cold. I understand it's old cold.
Yeah, we understand. Everyone who's done a medical degree understands old cold, but old cold belly badness. If you want to buy that book, old cold belly badness, it's the history of abdominal surgery by Karl Pilkington.
No, it just, you know, if
so,
if
but you put it in the freezer or something first.
You can do if you want, but they're normally cold anyway. Sort of thick glass and that, it holds the cold. But we don't smoke in our house, so I had to use a plate.
Oh, well, that's madness. A plate's not going to work. Famously, a plate doesn't work.
Oh, God, no!
So you put a plate on your belly, but that didn't do any...
That didn't work. So called Suzanne and said, oh, I'm in agony here. She said, go to the doctors then.
Good advice.
So
a lot of people have done that straight away, as opposed to going through the plate ashtray.
So he went to hospital, and they went to hospital and he said, have you got an ashtray?
Yeah. They went to fetch me an ashtray.
This is no smoking.
What is the closest thing to sort of living that's nothing?
I don't know what you mean.
What?
What's like the closest, like, do you know at some point something's gone from nothing to something, hasn't it?
No, I don't know. I don't understand what you mean.
Do you mean what is the first and lowest and most primitive and most simple form of life?
No,
he's right here in this room, Rick.
say like when you look at a stick insect,
right?
You go, right, there's a slight crossover there from a stick to a living thing.
No, it's not.
It didn't used to be a stick.
No, it's not. There's no biological relationship between it and a stick.
But there isn't much difference between the two, is what I mean.
Of course there is.
It's a huge difference.
They just sit there looking like a stick. That's their skill.
Yes, but there's nothing to do with being a stick. It's like camouflage. That's like saying when a soldier puts on combat gear, you're saying he's a cross between a human and a shrub.
What I'm saying is, have you seen them weird things that just look like... They sort of look like a leaf.
Yeah, they're insects that have evolved to look like a leaf.
At some point, something has had it away with a leaf.
No! What? At no point has something had it away with a leaf.
No, to make it look that much like a leaf.
At no point did a beetle shag a leaf. It's superficial. It's the way it looks. That's all it... That's like saying chameleons must have mated with green once. They are green.
No, but
it looks like a leaf.
But then how does it meet... How does it have relationships? It will be going around sort of having it away with a leaf.
No, it won't, because it doesn't know what it looks like. It doesn't matter. It's not like a stick insect will be talking to a stick for ages and go, oh, I've wasted my time here. This club's dead. Rude.
I was chatting to her and she was foxy, but she was giving me nothing.
But, Dave, that's not a stick insect, that's a stick.
What are you talking about?
That's a stick. You've been talking to a stick all night.
I can't believe it. I just thought she had a great, slim figure.
No, it's actually a real stick.
Well, I've been watching birds more than insects recently.
Oh, okay. You've moved on from
insects. In the last week, just because I've sort of looked at the ant and the bee and that. And what I've found with pigeons is they've got wings, yet they walk a lot.
I'd love that to be a thesis where he got like a £500,000 grant from a university, and I said, well, Pilkington seems to, he's done ants and he's done bees. He's followed ants. Apparently they're not doing anything. Some of them are lazy. We are granting him another £500,000. He's been working on it for a year. Please welcome Karl Pilkington.
Karl, what have you found?
Well, even though pigeons have wings, they walk a lot.
Well, I heard, and you told me this, so I know it's true.
What?
Do you know when I talked about replacing blood with coconut, what was it?
Well, one, it said, coconut milk can be used, as plasma, but yeah. I haven't had that verified, because it's off one of those websites where there are spurious facts.
Well, what do you think of that, Steve? I mean, I've sort of touched on it.
But I've just got to echo what Ricky said, I can't have an opinion unless it's been verified.
But why aren't you just being open-minded enough to go, well...
No,
but it's not being open-minded.
Open-minded isn't believing everything you hear. You don't believe everything you read, do you?
A lot of stuff you kind of go, well, that's interesting to...
But what, we talked about this, what about Noah's Ark?
What about it?
Well, you know, you said you believed it because it's in book form. But according to that, didn't he get two of every species on a big boat? But we know that's impossible, don't we?
Depends where he was. If he was above a zoo, there would have been a lot of different stuff knocking about. That's my only problem. What I'm saying is, where was he floating where he could get an elephant, a giraffe, a cat, a dog, a gerbil? Where were all these things floating about?
Well, exactly.
Right, these Old Testament zoos, they were quite
big. Yeah, but exactly. But you're right, you're questioning it. How is it possible?
But I've just said, a zoo.
There's no zoo that has got 1% of all animal species.
Well, I don't know where he got them from, then.
There's a couple of million species of animal. And how did he round these animals up?
Because they were drowning, so they were looking for any boat.
So they were looking, they were actively seeking out an ark.
Well, they would have just been looking for anything to get hold of.
Yeah, and where did he keep them all? How did he keep them all separate? How did he...
At that point...
Oh, no, the lion's at the otter.
No, because at that point, it's that thing, innit, of how you all pull together in it in a bad situation.
Talk shit.
You all chip in, they're all like, oh, God, you know, let's be nice to our neighbours.
Right, so there's spiders talking to flies and...
Well, they would have just gone elsewhere, wouldn't they?
What do you mean?
On another bit of the boat. The spiders don't have to knock about the lions just because they're all in it together. They get their own little area, don't they?
Well, I don't know. How big is this boat?
It's big. It's a big boat. How long... What was the warning he got from God to make it?
I don't know.
It's a couple of weeks.
Yeah. Two of every species, Karl. How big would this boat have to be?
Yeah, it's big.
You can't just keep saying it's big. Because I know in your mind, you're imagining this ark that's a boat with Noah up the front with his wife, two giraffes behind him, then next there, two elephants, and it just and it's just like elephant, giraffe, hippo, dog, cat, weasel, couple of frogs, and a spider talking to a fly going, let's get on. But when we're off here, you're dead.
But what would you have done then? Would you? Are you saying that you wouldn't get on there because it's too noisy?
It's not a question of what
it didn't happen.
Done.
It didn't happen.
To be honest, I'm not bothered. And they got through it, didn't they? They got through it. They're here now. We're not short of them. If anything, like I said, he didn't do us a favour because he saved too much. You can't move out there for stuff.
That's the jingle for excerpts from Karl's diary. This is all legitimate stuff. Ricky and I have had no input in this. This is the first time we get to read it. Went and did some shopping for stuff as it was my turn. Suzanne moaned a bit because I forgot orange juice and bought some cheap toilet paper. She always buys the expensive toilet paper. I don't know why they make toilet paper with pretty patterns on it.
That made it into the diary.
Up and out at 9 o'clock to go to the Cotswolds. Now, I think this was a gift for your girlfriend, wasn't it, for her birthday?
Yeah, it was a birthday, and that's, I just went for one night.
Got the car and headed off. We found the B&B, but they wouldn't let us in the room because we were early. We went for a walk. There was not much around the B&B, so we had a quick walk around the car park and went back in. Happy birthday. The room's now ready. It's an all right room. Free biscuits, so I ate them straight away. Like a child.
Like a dog. He runs in, jumps on the bed.
No. Get off the bed, not on the furniture. The room overlooked the car park that we'd already been round. You're staring at that window. Remember when we went there?
We'll always have the car park.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
The room had posh coat hangers in the wardrobe with sponge on them.
So I ate the sponge.
Don't think they are needed. We went and booked a table for Sunday dinner. I had beef. It was nice enough, but there was a family of 13 behind us. I don't see the point in going out in large numbers. They annoyed me. One of the family asked for sorbet before his next course. He was only about 11. He thought he was it. I said to Suzanne, I've had enough and needed a kip. Watched Planet Earth on BBC One. They filmed a panda for 4 weeks and all it did was sit in its cave. It did nout. If I was Fiat, I wouldn't name one of my cars after them as it suggests it won't work or go very far. It'd be like bringing out a Ford Sloth. No one would buy it.
A Ford Sloth! I would love that ad campaign! Oh, that's amazing! Oh, God!
The new Vauxhall Slug!
We had a look around the local village. There wasn't much to it. We did the usual thing and had a look around the church graveyard to see how old the dead people are.
Suzanne had it over time so far. She's gone to the Cotswolds, the room wasn't ready. She's seen the car park and they're, let's go and play how old the dead people are.
I like the fact that you mentioned we did the usual thing of having a look around the church graveyard. Do you make her do that every time you go away?
I want to know what she did for 2 hours when you slept.
She just looked out at the car park, just like, memories.
But that's what you do, though, isn't it, when you go to these places? There's nothing else, unless you want fudge. Or, you know, you walk around the church graveyard and have a look. It's nothing.
We went home. It took 3 hours to drive back. People say they go to the country to see the wildlife. I saw rabbits, pheasants and a fox on the way home. They were all dead in the road.